Welcome to Anatomy and Physiology at Glen Oaks Community College. I am Dr. Ren Hartung. For this video, we're going to talk about hormones that come from the pituitary gland. The pituitary gland, of course, is an endocrine gland that hangs off of the bottom of the brain by what's called the infundibulum. I talked in another video about the parts of the infundibulum and about the importance of the hypothalamus in controlling the pituitary gland. So for this video, I'm just going to talk about the hormones that are produced and released by the anterior pituitary gland. The whole pituitary gland. We'll talk first about the ones that are released by the anterior pituitary gland, and then we'll get to the ones that are released by the posterior pituitary gland. For the anterior, the first hormone I will talk about is FSH, or follicle-stimulating hormone. Follicle-stimulating hormone has an influence on the gonads. It's one of the hormones that we call gonadotropins. It was discovered in females, and its name tells you exactly what it does in females. It stimulates the follicles. Follicles are structures inside of the ovaries, and with follicle maturation and development, eventually we have the ovulation of the egg. So this hormone is important for reproduction. The next one is luteinizing hormone. And luteinizing hormone, or LH, also has an influence on the gonads. So it's the other gonadotropin. Luteinizing hormone is involved with ovulation. During the female cycle, there is a spike in luteinizing hormone, and that spike is the signal to that mature follicle to literally pop and release the egg. More details about that in reproductive system later on. So after FSH and LH, let's talk about TSH. TSH. TSH stands for Thyroid Stimulating Hormone. Another nice one. The name tells you exactly what it does. It stimulates the thyroid. In response to TSH, the thyroid releases its hormones. Another thing you should know about all of these so far, and most of the rest to come, they're also considered tropic or trophic hormones. That means that they cause hypertrophy in the glands or organs that they affect. So FSH and LH, for example, can cause the ovaries to enlarge, and the testicles as well. I forgot to mention FSH and LH are important in men as well. They're important for sperm production. TSH stimulates the thyroid to grow, but also, more importantly, probably to produce the thyroid hormones T3 and T4. Next hormone, ACTH, or adrenocorticotropic hormone. This hormone affects the adrenal gland, and yet again, the name tells you what it does, adrenocorticotropic hormone. It causes the adrenal glands to grow a little bit, but more importantly, it encourages the adrenal cortex to release cortisol and other cortical hormones, but mostly cortisol, as I understand. The next hormone, prolactin. This one is trying to tell you what it does. Lactation. It encourages the mammary glands in the female breast to produce milk. And probably if enough was produced in a male, you'd get the same result because we have these glands as well. So that's prolactin. Levels of prolactin increase when baby breastfeeds. And that's part of an interesting first positive feedback loop when baby first attempts breastfeeding, and then part of a negative feedback loop to maintain a stable milk production for the baby. The next one is growth hormone. And we're back to hormones whose name tell you exactly what they do. Growth hormone is important for growth. It doesn't work alone, I should tell you that first. Growth hormone causes the release of other hormones that we call insulin-like growth factors. And together, the insulin-like growth factors with growth hormone cause a bunch of different effects. One of them is to increase proliferation at the epiphyseal plates in the ends of the long bones so that the bones get longer. Another major area that's influenced by these is energy. They have effects that increase energy availability. It's important to have enough energy to grow when you're growing, so they have an effect on that. The last one that I will talk about for the anterior pituitary gland is a hormone called MSH, melanocyte-stimulating hormone. This one also tells you exactly what it does. It stimulates melanocytes. Melanocytes are the cells, for example, in our skin that make pigment molecules, melanin. So an increase in this hormone would cause an increase in pigmentation. That is it for the anterior pituitary gland. Let's talk about the posterior pituitary gland. The posterior pituitary gland, one thing to remember about the posterior pituitary gland, this does not make the hormones. The hormones are made up here in the hypothalamus for the posterior pituitary gland. They're made by neurons that live up here in the hypothalamus, and then the hormones travel down the axons of those neurons and await release in the axon terminals of those neurons. The two hormones are ADH, or antidiuretic hormone. Again, it tells you exactly what it does, as long as you know what a diuretic is. Diuretics are either drugs or substances that cause us to produce more urine, to have a much greater urine volume. This hormone is an antidiuretic. It prevents or decreases the amount of urine that we produce. Specifically, it tells the kidneys to retain more water, so there's less water in our urine. A couple of neat things to talk about with ADH, or antidiuretic hormone. It's also known as vasopressin. And we can administer it as a drug as vasopressin. It's administered for two reasons. One is to treat a condition known as diabetes insipidus. In the patient with diabetes insipidus, their posterior pituitary gland is not releasing enough antidiuretic hormone. So their kidneys are not being told to retain water. They're not retaining water. They're peeing water out excessively. So they tend to pee like a racehorse. The person with diabetes insipidus, if they're peeing a lot more and losing a lot of water, they would also be thirsty. So they're also drinking like a racehorse. That's the story of ADH and diabetes insipidus. I also said that's one of the reasons that we give this as a drug, that we give vasopressin as a drug. The other reason is if somebody's in severe vascular shock, their blood pressure is really low, we can give really high levels of ADH or vasopressin, and that in its higher than normal physiological levels, it has an effect of vasoconstriction. So if somebody's blood pressure is really low and we give them vasopressin, then their blood vessels constrict and that increases the blood pressure. It can save a life. So that's, sorry, maybe too much about antidiuretic hormone. The last one, the final one, I promise, is oxytocin. Oxytocin is the only one that doesn't really give you a clue about what it does, but it has two major functions. One of them is during labor, childbirth. It's part of a positive feedback loop. This hormone causes uterine contractions. And when those contractions happen, that leads to the production of more of this hormone, and we get an increase in uterine contractions until eventually the baby is born. The other function that oxytocin has also on the female body is called milk letdown. That's where the milk is delivered by the lactiferous ducts towards the nipple. So we talked about prolactin that causes milk to be produced. That just causes the milk to be made. Then the milk sits in the glands. When oxytocin is released, then the ducts that lead to the glands start contracting and pushing milk towards the nipple. Let me count these and make sure I've got all of them. From the anterior, we should have 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And then from the posterior, 2. So I've covered all of the endocrine glands from the pituitary gland. If you have any questions, please feel free to leave them in the comments down below, or comments or critiques, feel free. Otherwise, thank you for watching.